Port of New York in New Jersey is the busiest port on the east coast of North America. It's a highway that everybody has to share.
It's a unique harbor, and they have so much activity with all different sized boats. You got kayaks, you got sailboats, you got little motorboats. You have a major shipping channel with large container ships and oil tankers and barges, as opposed to a typical recreational boating harbor where you don't have the shipping traffic.
The sailboat guys always complain about the motorboats. Motorboats always complain about sailboats. Ferries get in everybody's way. It's endless.
When you're dealing with a ferry and a cruise liner, it gets confusing and kind of dangerous.
There's a lot of inexperienced people out here.
And not everybody understands the rules of the road.
12-year-old learning to sail at rush hour on a Friday when there's 30 ferry boats running around, that can be a bit of a conflict.
There's very little communication out there. Sometimes it's tough to know the other vessel's intention.
A lot of people think because they're underwater, they cannot get hurt. You could get killed.
It's a mixed-use highway, and everybody thinks they own a piece of it. I don't know what the answer is, but it's our job to make it work.
There's a cargo ship coming in. She's 965 feet long, 106 feet wide, and draws 42 feet under the water. Enter the pilot to guide her through the narrow channels and congested fairways of New York Harbor.
Most vessels come right up across the ocean to make the dock at a certain time. Ships do not want to wait. We won't make them wait. We are always there.
We're heading off the board now, and we'll be bringing her on into the Port of New York.
That's about 10 or 11 decks. Luckily, this ship has an elevator. Captain Bill McGovern, welcome to New York. Last port?
Last port?
Last port.
Last port, Shanghai, China.
Straight from Shanghai, yeah. Very good. This pilot is well aware of what's going on up ahead as opposed to a captain. For all the ports they go to, it would be absolute overload to try and comprehend all the stuff that might be going on in a port. And that is the necessity of the pilot.
Is the NYK Meteor, we're inbound approaching the entrance buoys Ambrose.
Captain,
CL1 whistle.
Have a nice day.
You too.
We have a tanker outbound coming towards us, ferry traffic. Things shooting across us from side to side.
By that buoy, there's a small boat, but unless you look carefully, it looks just like the water. It looks like another white cap.
There's one cutting right in front of us. What the heck is he thinking?
Here we can see another one.
And there's another boat right up there ahead, sitting in the same line.
We don't know what is going through the mind of the boater. We can communicate with other ships, but we have no idea what that boater is thinking.
We have a blind spot 500 meters ahead of the ship. You assume that I see you and I may not.
If that engine conked out at the wrong time, there is nothing that can be done.
A lot of people don't realize the displacement of a ship that's 20, 30,000 tons of water filling a void will suck you in. Pull you right up into the ship. It could end your life.
A container ship or tanker can't leave the channel, and they can't back it up. If they reversed engines, the water would move away from the rudder, not past it, losing the ability to steer. The ship would veer out of control, causing a puncture in its hull that could spell disaster for the harbor.
This is a stressful, stressful situation.
343.
Heading 343.
Very good.
As a pilot, you really have to figure out everything that might go wrong and prevent that.
Here's our tugboat coming now, Captain.
This tugboat is going to be coming alongside.
Stop the engine again.
Stop the engine. Engine stop, sir.
Very good.
The docking pilot will relieve the Sandy Hook pilot and take us up to the dock. We can dock a lot quicker with tugboats. These dredges can't move. Captain Piver with the tug is maneuvering in between this small gap. This harbor, it's our life. It's what we're entirely dedicated to, keeping it safe and protecting it. And that's why we ask to please leave the channel if your ship is coming. Just go on the outside of it.
Smart boaters, do your part. Steer clear of the channel.
If you are broken down, walk out on deck, take something bright, and wave your arm to show us that you are disabled.
Before you hit the water, check out the Safe Harbor online for safety tips, local resources, and more. The Port of New York and New Jersey is a highway, but it's also a public space.
Recreational paddling is exploding. It's on a huge growth curve, and as a kayaker, it's like the Wild West down there. You have ferry traffic, you got recreational boaters. It's tough out there.
My biggest problem with kayaks is that I can't see them sometimes.
You don't see it until you're right on it, and then it might be too late.
Sometimes there's groups of four or five of them right smack in the middle of the channel. Sometimes they're moving, sometimes they're just sitting still.
I don't know. I wouldn't be on one out in the river.
The waterfront is being open to the people. I think all of our job is to nudge it along just a little bit in that direction.
When we launch, I want you to be aware of a couple of things. Number one, I've been paddling on this river for 29 years. 29 years.
This might be one of the most diverse boathouses there are. We have touring kayaks, sea kayaks, outrigger canoe singles, outrigger canoe doubles. Very few boats that we don't have in the paddling world that come out of here. Tonight we teach people an accelerated paddle basics class. They introduce them to the river and to the currents in our river and all the vagaries.
I'm Margaret Mann. I've been paddling in New York Harbor for about 8 years. I paddle for recreation and to escape from the city. It keeps you alert, because if you're not, the consequences could be severe. We staged that collision.
You throw me that paddle.
I wasn't in that boat, and I'm really glad I wasn't.
One of the more difficult situations is where you have boathouses like we created on the west side of Manhattan, directly proximal to high-velocity ferry terminals like the one at West 39th Street. Crossing that path really creates a difficult situation where everybody has to be more alert and aware.
Sometimes we'll get some really, really close calls. You assume they see you. It's a 100-foot vessel, but sometimes they're oblivious. You just never want to assume that the other person knows what they're doing or sees you. So you always err on the side of caution.
When you're in a kayak approaching a ferry terminal, the first thing you do is hold to read the traffic, to get a sense of when the right moment will be to cross.
Usually these ferries, they're not paid to sit at the dock very long, maybe 2 minutes, 3 minutes tops. If you see a group of kayaks, you'll know that they're going to be just about behind you when you're ready to pull out.
So you wait, watching the terminal for boats coming out and watching the river, north and south, for boats coming in.
You have a fairly decent view, but there's always that blind spot behind the ventilator there, and just about anybody could sneak behind you.
Never try to sneak across a ferry backing out. Always wait until it's left the terminal.
If they could actually make some sort of visual signal, a hand wave, it's greatly appreciated on our part.
Let's do it.
Probably the most challenging place to paddle in New York Harbor is the Battery. Boats come from all directions. There's no clear channel to paddle in. It's hard to know where to be. So you want to make your intentions very clear. Either wait or paddle. But when you make that decision, it should be very clear to the other vessels, and you need to act decisively and quickly. You have to wait for your opening, and you want to aim for its stern. You don't want to cross in front of its bow unless you are positive you have enough time to get across.
You can't stress enough how difficult it is to see a kayak on the water.
Visibility can be a real issue out in the Hudson River. We just assume that we're invisible, that the other motorized traffic doesn't know you're there. The main way we manage that is we wear bright clothing. We usually have bright vessels. And if we're working in the evening, we have lights.
If you're going to paddle at night, you need to be seen. So you put a white light on your stern or the back of your boat.
Especially in the city where there's so much white light, it's really important to have green and red lights to distinguish you as a vessel. The green is always on the right and the red is always on the left. It helps a boat that's looking at millions and millions of city lights see something red and green, and they're just, a captain's eye is just trained to see it, to see you as a vessel instead of just another white light in a city of white lights.
Even with lights, your visibility at night is extremely limited. So stay close to shore and be alert to other traffic.
Even in this intensely urban environment, I'm absolutely connected to nature. I'm feeling the current, I'm feeling the wind, and you're responsible for your personal safety. Nobody else is responsible. Whenever I come off the water, I feel like I've had an adventure, you know, right here in Manhattan. I've had this amazing encounter with nature.
I think here's the takeaway for commercial boaters when in reference to operating around kayakers. Don't assume that we actually are experienced or competent kayakers, and don't even assume that we are necessarily in total control. Give us a little space. We'll give you a little space. I promise we will make as much of an effort as you will, and I think we can all do great out here.
A great assistance to us with ascertaining who's going to cross whose bow is when a paddler will lift his paddle out of the water and maybe over his head, or a hand wave. It's a great idea if they could actually make some sort of visual signal to each other to establish who's going to cross whose bow.
Radios are great, VHF is great, but it's not exactly the easiest thing in rough, bumpy water like this to be able to drop your paddle, pick it up, and answer. All in all, though, it's a good idea to have one, at least in your hatch.
Know what the river's doing before you hit the water.
Make yourself visible, and then assume that you're not. But most of all, take a guided tour or safety course from a local outfitter before you attempt to navigate the strong currents and congested fairways of New York Harbor.
Try to make eye contact if at all possible. We're certainly looking for you.
If you see a kayaker in distress, you're gonna know it. Capsized boat, hands waving in the air, any of those kinds of things that are clear signs that that person needs help. Recreational paddling is exploding. So you're gonna get some yahoos out there who are new and don't really understand where they should be and where they shouldn't, and those are the ones that you gotta watch out for.
Before you hit the water, check out the Safe Harbor to learn more about guided tours, internet resources, and where to learn how to paddle safely in the port of New York and New Jersey.
People learning to sail can be a problem. They can't get out of our way as well as we'd like them to.
Sailboats are sometimes difficult to see what directions they're heading in.
Either going with the wind, going opposite the wind, they tend to change the direction every 5 seconds, you know? It's confusion. Kind of dangerous.
The port of New York and New Jersey has been a sailing destination for hundreds of years, but today, sailors share the water with many boaters who don't understand how they navigate or how to read their intentions.
My name's Kate Field.
I'm a captain here at Classic Harbor Line on the schooner Adirondack, and we're going to be taking a sail down to the Statue of Liberty and back. So that's the signal for backing up, engines in reverse. Going to watch for traffic as we come out of the piers. We've got one boat coming down the river, but not too close. We'll be out of his way, no problem.
日本から来ました。で、初めてのニューヨークの、観光なんで、スタチュー、自由の女神を見るのを楽しみにしてます。
This trip is really special to me because we're going to go by the Statue of Liberty, and you know, my family did come through Ellis Island, and it's kind of amazing just to see how they came to the United States.
Raising sail is a very vulnerable time. A lot of my attention goes towards making sure that the rigging is running properly. I really have reduced maneuverability. I have crew that are working with sails that are partway up, so they're not really able to adjust them at that point. So it's harder to get the boat to go where you want it at this stage. We really need to stay into the wind, so we can't really turn very quickly. At this point, our engines are going to go off. Our sails are going to go way out. And we're sailing down the river. Kind of have to think two steps ahead when sailing all the time, because we actually can't go in every direction that we want. Right now, I have the Spirit Cruise boat off my port side on the left here, and I also have this tug and barge off my starboard side here on the right. And right now, I'm sort of threading the needle between them, so what I'm going to do is kind of let the Spirit Cruise go by, let the tug and barge go by, then we'll dive over to the other side of the river when we have a clear path to get over there. Ready to jab? In the middle of a jibe is one of our most vulnerable times. Jibe ho! Perhaps the most reduced maneuverability that we have. The main thing that it means is that we're switching course. Visibility in front is limited. We have the sails and we also have the rigging. It's much better for boats to be sort of behind us than directly in front of us. The most troublesome other vessels that we have out here are small recreational power boaters. As soon as they start to come too close up towards the bow, if we get a gust of wind, it can have our course change a little and can end up having it change right towards them. The wider the berth we can have, the better. 200 feet at least, as a minimum. Jibe ho! We try to get to the Statue of Liberty in the cleanest route we can, the shortest route that we can. Generally, we can't stop. If there's any wind in our sails, those sails are going to keep us moving whether we want to move or not. I have to sort of turn all the way up around towards the wind to stop the boat, and that takes some time.
Wow. This is the closest I've ever been to the Statue of Liberty. It's amazing.
Yay!
My ancestors, they would have been on a sailboat, and it was the way to sort of get a sense of what they must have felt like. That was special.
I just feel really fortunate that I get to live right over there, but spend my days out here on the water in the sun. We like to get as many people out here every summer as we can to experience that with us.
Give all sailing vessels plenty of room. Sailors change course quickly, have limited visibility, can't stop, and are vulnerable when raising sail. To learn more about sailing basics, local resources, and protocols, check out the Safe Harbor online.
You've got to be aware that there are motorboaters out there that really don't have a clue.
You don't know exactly what they're going to do. You don't necessarily feel like they're paying attention. So yeah, there are times when I see a motorboater and I'm a little anxious.
Any wackadoodle can buy a mega yacht. The salesman will give them 20 minutes of how to run the boat and let them loose, and they have no idea how much damage they could cause. The 30-foot boat moving at 30 miles an hour. Before you know it, you can be on top of somebody.
So it's really defensive driving. You're just looking around 360 and watching where everyone's going, you know, making sure that you're not cutting in front of somebody else or somebody else isn't cutting in front of you. It is a free-for-all out there. It's definitely a free-for-all.
My name is Jim Chambers. I've been a captain on vessels in New York Harbor for over 50 years. I've run everything from police boats to ferries, the Adirondack 2, the Manhattan, the Spirit of New York. I made a career out of being the most available relief captain in New York Harbor. But now I am pretty much retired and playing on my own vessel, the Osprey, for fun and pleasure. Recreational boating in the Port of New York is growing at great strides.
The waterfront's being rediscovered in the city. For a period of time, nobody thought about going in the Hudson River. You know, it's just so polluted. And now it's cleaned up. A lot of boating, a lot of recreational pursuits.
Look at the number of people out here enjoying New York Harbor.
Some of the things to worry about. Swift currents. The tide runs very fast through here. And you've got wakes to deal with.
Sailboats don't leave a wake. Kayaks don't leave a wake. Motorboats make noise, they make wakes. That's why everybody seems to focus on them.
We try our best to limit anything that can happen from our wake, but there are times I can put out a 1 foot, 2 foot wake. That's enough to roll over a kayak. It's enough to impact a small boat if people aren't ready for it. But when you're in a waterway this wide, if I was going someplace in particular, there's going to be a wake. So plan for it and deal with it. Turn your boat a couple degrees into it or away from it, and the wake will pass under you. Know how to handle it.
When you're out boating, it's a pleasure. It's a recreational activity. So a lot of people do drink. Part of owning a boat and being captain of the boat is the people on it you're responsible for. You gotta drive the boat and keep them safe, so you really can't drink.
You know, it's fine for your guests to have a cocktail or two, but keep the bottle corked when you're running the boat. It's something that has to be dealt with, and enforcement is still part of it. Alcohol-related incidents, though they're less than they were, still exist. If I had one specific suggestion to increase boating safety, it would be very simple. It would be stay focused. Pay attention to what you're doing. It is a serious business, and the mistakes have serious consequences.
The New York Harbor is becoming one of the top resort areas of the world. People coming here from all over.
Anybody that's starting into the motorboating community before they get behind the wheel of a vessel is take a safe boating course and understand what the rules of the road are so that they don't go out there and create havoc in the harbor.
The courses teach you the basics on crossing, overtaking, oncoming situations, and how to deal with them. It's good to know how to read a buoy and how to navigate and how to stay in deep water instead of on the rocks.
For a long time, the people were fenced off. They didn't want people to get to the river. Now they're opening it up. Things are starting to change. Things are turning around, I think, for the better. And it's in our backyard. That's the neatest thing.
To find out where boating safety courses are offered near you, check out the Safe Harbor online.
In a harbor like this, it's like being on the New Jersey Turnpike. From people-powered craft to sailing vessels to high-speed ferries that are moving at 40 miles an hour through the harbor. Some critical variables are understanding one another, communicating with one another, respecting one another. Understanding what one another's intentions are is the first part of safety.
Anybody that's starting into the motorboating community, the first thing they should do is take a safe boating course and understand what the rules of the road are.
There's an unwritten rule. It's called the rule of gross tonnage. Big fish eat little fish. You may have the right of way, but you don't want that in your eulogy.
Do not cross the bow of a tanker.
Cargo ships move fast, can't stop, and can't leave the channel.
We have a blind spot 500 meters ahead of the ship. You assume that I see you and I may not.
And if your engine goes, you're gone.
The tugboats and barges that go around here, you have to know how they operate so you can stay away from them and operate safely.
It's really up to the boaters themselves to get out of the way.
Sailboats have the right of way. I also try to give them space. I don't want them to have to veer off course.
Give all sailing vessels plenty of room. Sailors change course quickly, have limited visibility, and are vulnerable when raising sail.
When you see a kayak, you gotta stay away from them because any wave could turn the kayak over and they could be in serious trouble.
You can't stress enough how difficult it is to see a kayak.
Maximize visibility with brightly colored clothing and boats, and use navigation lights at night. Make visual contact with other vessels whenever possible. Stay out of the channel. But when you do interact with other traffic, make your intentions clear and always cross their stern.
Know what the river is doing before you hit the water. Currents are a factor. The current on the Hudson can get to 3 knots.
The tide changes every 6 hours. The weather changes all the time. So check your advisories. Keep an eye on the weather.
To be safe, be prepared. Stay alert, be aware, and know how to read the intentions and capabilities of the vessels around you.
There are many tribes here. There are those that know what they're doing and those that have no idea what they're doing.
There's got to be a way to communicate among all of the parties to see if we can somehow resolve these issues.
It's only through that communication that everybody begins to experience this as one tribe. We are one tribe, we are mariners. Whether you're in a sailboat or a kayaker, anybody on the water looks out for everybody on the water. This is, it's a good thing to be part of.
Thank you.